Hello and welcome to another episode of Virtual Legality. I'm your host, Richard Hoeg, managing member of the Hoeg Law Business Law Firm of Northville, Michigan. And today, like all days in Virtual Legality, we are, of course, going to talk about the hot button political topics and issues of the day. No, I'm just kidding. We've got an American flag on your screen in front of you because we are going to talk about something a bit more, let's call it substantial, of importance to folks, especially in the United States, looking at the U.S. elections both next week and for the weeks thereafter. But we are not going to change Virtual Legality into some kind of political YouTube channel that just features a lawyer talking about politics all the time in every video. Right, Legal? We wouldn't do that. And yes, I'm just kidding with you. But no, we are instead going to talk about a very specific document that came out from the Supreme Court of the United States yesterday that I think is going to impact a lot of things in the upcoming weeks if the election is close at all, and not just close on a federal level, but close on any state level. This is actually a denial of cert. This is saying that, or denial for expediting of cert, that the Supreme Court is not going to consider this question on an expedited basis. They're going to wait for later. And in fact, they're going to wait until after the election to decide these important things. Now, we don't usually talk about things in this space in respect of the Supreme Court that is anything south of an official opinion, because this is all process stuff. This doesn't actually settle anything under the law. But this is important enough and worth keeping your eyes on enough that I really wanted to talk to you all about it, because this is the kind of thing, as a rule of law guy, as a lawyer guy, I look at and say, oh, there is a real potential for danger, for damage to the institutions, for respect for the institutions like the Supreme Court, like various state governments, like the federal government in and of itself. And I look at this and I say, this is a very unique situation. And even though we normally talk about pop culture in this space, I wanted to talk with you all about it. Now, this is mostly going to apply to those of you that are United States citizens that are casting a vote or electing not to in the election next week. But if you are from out of town, if you're from somewhere else, hopefully this is still interesting to you, because this is likely to be part of the story after the election results start to be tabulated here in the United States. And it's probably going to be a little bit ugly. So in this document from yesterday, this is from a lawsuit from the Republican Party of Pennsylvania against the Secretary of Pennsylvania about the election procedures. This was denied, so this won't be seen by the court early. And in red here is a very important piece of this puzzle. Justice Barrett, the newly announced Amy Coney Barrett, Justice of the Supreme Court, which is, of course, a no part a politically safe or not fraught topic to discuss in this space. Obviously, many, many people have their own opinions on that process, but she is, in fact, now an Associate Justice of the Supreme Court. She didn't have anything to do with this decision, this denial, and her vote is going to be important on Election Day and thereafter. And most people think, based on what she has said in the past, that she is going to come down on the side of, whether you want to call it originalism or textualism, the side of the conservative bloc of the Supreme Court with respect to these questions. So that's an important piece of what is happening here. Now, in respect of this denial, there is a statement of Justice Alito, Justice Thomas, and Justice Gorsuch that says the following. The court's handling of the important constitutional issue raised by this matter has needlessly created conditions that could lead to serious post-election problems. The Supreme Court of Pennsylvania has issued a decree that squarely alters an important statutory provision enacted by the Pennsylvania legislature pursuant to its authority under the Constitution of the United States to make rules governing the conduct of elections for federal office. So most of what we're going to talk about today, what is at issue in this case, and you'll see that this is actually a statement that is joining the denial of expediting of the cert, because you will see in this opinion slash just statement from Justice Alito that he doesn't think there's enough time to decide these issues and that the Supreme Court has really made a hash of all this. And I tend to agree. But at the heart of this question is Section 1, Article 2 of the U.S. Constitution that says as follows. Each state shall appoint in such manner as the legislature thereof may direct a number of electors equal to the whole number of senators and representatives to which the state may be entitled in the Congress. And those electors are going to meet and they're going to elect the president of the United States. But it's in such manner as the legislature thereof may direct. And what importance you give to that language that is at issue at the heart of all these cases. Now, again, I'm not a politics channel here. I'm not here to ascribe a specific reading of this to you, but I can tell you that there is a fundamental schism on the Supreme Court regarding whether or not the quote-unquote legislature has decided election rules if the courts of that state revise those rules in some fashion. So what you see here in this statement is a statement that says, hey, the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania stepped in and changed the rules, and that's not okay. In a law called Act 77, the legislature permitted all voters to cast their ballots by mail, but unambiguously required that all mailed ballots be received by 8 p.m. on Election Day. That was an act of the legislature, a law. It also specified that if this provision was declared invalid, much of the rest of Act 77, including its liberalization of mail-in voting, would be void. That the legislature of Pennsylvania added some new rules for COVID-19 that allowed certain new things to happen in mail-in voting, but they kept to the received by 8 p.m. on Election Day rule. The legislature subsequently made it clear that in its judgment, the COVID-19 pandemic did not call for any change in the Election Day deadline. In a law enacted in March 2020, the legislature addressed election-related issues caused by the pandemic, but it chose not to amend the deadline for the receipt of mailed ballots. In the face of Act 77's deadline, the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, by a vote of 4-3, decreed that mailed ballots need not be received by Election Day. Instead, it imposed a different rule. Ballots are to be treated as timely if they are postmarked on or before Election Day and are received within 3 days thereafter. In addition, and this is one of the things that I have a personal problem with, again, you get my opinions and editorialization sometimes in this space, the court ordered that a ballot with no postmark or an illegible postmark must be regarded as timely if it is received by that same date. And that's not great, right? We are all concerned about having a fair, safe, and secure election, and the court has stepped in and said, hey, if you don't have a postmark and you deliver it after Election Day, it's all fine. And I can certainly see why there is some consternation at the Supreme Court level with that particular decision. The court expressly acknowledged that the statutory provision mandating receipt by Election Day was unambiguous and that its abrogation of that rule was not based on an interpretation of the statute. It further conceded that the statutory deadline was constitutional on its face, but it claimed broad power to do what it thought was needed to respond to a natural disaster, and it justified its decree as necessary to protect voters' rights under the Free and Equal Elections Clause of the state constitution. Many state constitutions have more fulsome protections and rights for things like voting than the federal constitution. And in general, the state courts are charged with interpreting their own state constitutions. That's why you will see in various places on the internet when you see talk of these kinds of decisions, and certainly the decisions to follow, that the federal Supreme Court should not be in the business of interpreting state law for the state courts. And in general, as an overall kind of precept, a rule, I agree. In general, the federal courts should not be in the business of interpreting the state law for the states themselves. But there is this counter statement. There's this counter concept that at a federal level, the U.S. Constitution has charged the legislature of the states with the power to determine how electors are elected. And so when that starts to become a problem, when a state court changes the rules that the legislature has put forth, I can certainly see this side of the argument, as well as I can see the side of the argument that says, hey, look, we just want more votes. We think everybody is fair. There's very little chance of fraud, and everybody should get a chance to put something in. This is a very unusual year, right? But here, the statement is that the court shouldn't be doing what the legislature didn't prescribe. But they also point out in this particular statement that both the Republicans and the Democrats wanted this settled. And I agree with that more than I agree with any particular interpretation of the Constitution in this particular law, that this needed to be settled before Election Day. Instead of doing what either party sought, the court simply denied the stay. Now, you've been in Virtual Legality before, you know that I have my problems with Chief Justice John Roberts. This is one of them. He will demur on every point that he views as potentially controversial so that he can kick the ball down the road. And in this particular case, what he has done is he has pushed these questions past the election to the place in time where they will be the most potentially damaging for everybody involved. Democrats, Republicans, Supreme Courts, state courts alike. As Alito says here, it would be highly desirable to issue a ruling on the constitutionality of the state Supreme Court's decision before the election. That question has national importance, and there is a strong likelihood, showing in this particular statement where he falls on this question, that the state Supreme Court decision violates the federal constitution. the provisions of the federal constitution conferring on state legislatures, not state courts, the authority to make rules governing federal elections would be meaningless if a state court could override the rules adopted by the legislature simply by claiming that a state constitutional provision gave the courts the authority to make whatever rules it thought appropriate for the conduct of a fair election. Now, again, in broad strokes, I agree with this concept, right? There are certainly things that a state court could do that would clearly take the power out of the hands of the legislature. If the legislature said, hey, election day is right here, you have to get everything in by now, and then the state Supreme Court said, no, you can vote next year, then that's clearly taking the power out of the legislature. Or no, these folks in these zip codes can't vote, or these folks can get double votes, or whatever the Supreme Court might decide, clearly taking power out of the hands of the state legislature. The question becomes one of degrees, right? What they have done here is said, okay, you get a couple of extra days and we don't need a postmark. And does that usurp the power from the legislature in respect to this question? Now, again, in my opinion, probably yes. But the Supreme Court of the United States has to be very careful about stepping in to political questions that are governed by state law. And here, I think, is where we're really going to have some potential damage. Says, hey, I reluctantly conclude that there is simply not enough time at this late date to decide the question before the election, but also that does not mean that the state court decision must escape our review. In addition, the court's denial of the motion to expedite is not a denial of a request for this court to order that ballots received after election day be segregated. We've been told that the Attorney General in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania has issued guidance directing county boards of elections to segregate ballots based on the time received, and nothing in the court's order today precludes petitioner, the Republican Party of Pennsylvania, from applying to this court for additional relief if it is not satisfied with the secretary's guidance. We will be looking at this again later, and if Pennsylvania is important to the federal decision on who the president is, we will be looking at it in a very substantive capacity, perhaps more so than the famous Bush v. Gore decisions in 2000. And again, we've got a justice now that's joined the Supreme Court that hasn't said one way or the other which way her allegiance is going to go, where she's going to read the law on this particular question. But most people think she's going to join this block, which means that what we have built here, what Chief Justice Roberts has built here, is a situation in which the Supreme Court has ignored the question not once but twice in Pennsylvania, and more justices than not are likely to void the actual votes that were received in that interregnum period after Election Day. And if that election is close, it could tip Pennsylvania and could tip the federal election. Now, you see here Alito, Thomas, Gorsuch. We don't know where Barrett will fall. You might be asking yourselves, how, Rick, are you getting to 5 votes for this proposition? The answer to that is that Justice Kavanaugh, in the court's decision to not stay a vacation of a federal rule that would have extended Wisconsin ballot deadlines. And I know there's a lot of things that are going on here. But again, in Wisconsin, it was a federal court that stepped in. In Pennsylvania, it's a state court that stepped in. And the federal court question is a little bit more obvious, that federal courts shouldn't be doing this, shouldn't be stepping in and changing the way that state elections take place. State courts doing it is a closer question, and that's the Pennsylvania problem. Justice Kavanaugh, however, put in a footnote to the Wisconsin decision the following: a federal court's alteration of state election laws, such as Wisconsin's, differs in some respects from a state court's alteration of state election laws. That said, under the U.S. Constitution, the state courts do not have a blank check to rewrite state election laws for federal elections. Article 2, which we just talked about, expressly provides that the rules for presidential elections are established by the states in such manner as the legislature thereof may direct. The text of Article 2 means that the clearly expressed intent of the legislature must prevail, and that a state court may not depart from the state election code enacted by the legislature. And then you see Bush v. Gore and Bush v. Palm Beach County canvassing. In a presidential election, in other words, a state court's significant departure from the legislative scheme for appointing presidential electors presents a federal constitutional question. This is not, as Justice Kavanaugh says, a question that the federal Supreme Court has to just avoid because it's just a state law question. Once you drag in Article 2 of the U.S. Constitution, it is the type of question that the court at the Supreme Court level believes that it can answer. He also quotes Chief Justice Rehnquist in that particular decision, who was concurring and whose opinion was not adopted by the whole unanimous court. that said to attach definitive weight to the pronouncement of a state court when the very question at issue is whether the court has actually departed from the statutory meaning would be to abdicate our responsibility to enforce the explicit requirements of Article 2. The text of the Constitution requires federal courts to ensure that state courts do not rewrite state election laws that are put forth by the legislature. So at the end of the day, you look at what Kavanaugh has said here, you combine it with what Alito and Thomas and Gorsuch have said here, and Justice Barrett arrives at a court in tumult. Roberts, where is he going to fall? He hasn't actually spoken on any of these. You don't actually see Kavanaugh joining this statement. And you see this actually in further decisions that are happening at the court, right? You see the Pennsylvania problem writ large across many states. Again, Justice Barrett didn't join this particular case, happening in North Carolina. You've got Gorsuch and Alito talking very similarly to the way that they did in the Pennsylvania case. Thomas doesn't join their statement here, but they note in North Carolina, the General Assembly judged it appropriate to retain certain other existing election rules, like the state's deadline for the receipt of absentee ballots. And despite the General Assembly's considered judgment about the appropriate response to COVID, other state actors, including the State Board of Elections, recently chose to issue their own additional and supplemental set of amendments to state election laws. The parties before us all acknowledge that under the federal Constitution, only the state legislature and Congress may prescribe the times, places, and manner of holding elections. Besides, even assuming that the North Carolina General Assembly could delegate its election clause authority to other officials, its representatives contend before us that it has not authorized the deadline extension here, and understandably so. The change the board adopted was deemed unnecessary by the General Assembly when it retained the statutory ballot receipt deadline after considering COVID's impact on election processes. Respectfully, for all these reasons, I would grant the application to stay the board's action. And we don't know where any of this falls after the election. There are multiple states implicated. There are many more that are in various states of undress with respect to federal challenges, state challenges, many different parties. And the ultimate thing that I would give as a takeaway here, I call it the Pennsylvania problem, is that the Supreme Court has, in this month before the election, abdicated its responsibility to actually establish what the rules of various elections are across the United States. And what that has created through that abdication, regardless of where you come down on this question, because the Supreme Court hasn't answered it one way or the other, what we've got is we've got a situation where votes that are being cast under present rules may nonetheless be voided because those rules were established in the judiciary in a manner that a Supreme Court with a brand new justice might determine after the fact and actually determine the outcome of a United States election. Or as I said in a tweet yesterday, this is cruising for a real tire fire if ACB is on the side we'd expect in favor of voiding the Pennsylvania Supreme Court's judicially created deadline extension. If the late arriving votes of a close election are voided by SCOTUS after declining to answer the question twice, hoo boy. And that's all I can leave you with today in Virtual Legality. We are heading for something next week, and I guess we'll just see how it goes. Certainly, if you're in the United States, take the opportunity to vote. Check out the various elections, not just at the federal level, but what's happening locally and in your state. Those are important questions, and hopefully you get a chance to do so. Otherwise, this is kind of what we talk about in Virtual Legality all the time. Certainly business and law, certainly through pop culture lenses like video games, music, movies, and television. Also, occasionally, Supreme Court decisions and issues of supreme political and just general citizenry importance. If you caught this on YouTube, thank you so much for watching. And if you listen to it as a podcast, thank you so much for listening. And I will catch you on the very next episode of Virtual Legality. Virtual Legality is a YouTube video series with audio podcast versions presented as commentary and for education and entertainment purposes only. It does not constitute legal advice and does not create an attorney-client relationship. If you have legal questions about the topics discussed, please consult your own legal counsel.